Hello, you are listening to Classic Stage Company's first podcast ever. My name is Tony Speciale, and I am the Associate Artistic Director here. And it is my great pleasure to welcome playwright Sarah Ruhl. Thank you, Sarah, for coming today.
Thanks for having me.
So I just have a few questions for you. Your play Orlando is running here through October 17th. And my first question is, tell us a little bit about the story of Orlando and maybe even Virginia Woolf.
Well, it's a very wild ride, Orlando. Orlando starts as a nobleman in the 16th century, and we follow him all the way through the 20th century, and he becomes a woman somewhere along the way. And it's really Woolf's most fantastical escapade in terms of her novel writing. And she said she was sort of sick of writing novels, and she wanted to write something that was part poem, part play, part, you know, fabulation, basically. And she was also writing a love letter to Vita Sackville-West, who was the great love of her life, in addition to Leonard Woolf, who I think she also really, really loved. So Orlando becomes a compendium of Vita Sackville-West's life, and there are all these amazing personal symbols throughout the novel that are really about Vita, about her ancestral home, about her extensive collection of lovers, her cross-dressing. So I think it's a love letter, it's a romp, it's a meditation about time, it's about the act of writing, it's about writing through time, it's about how the individual can exist within any given historical parameters.
Well, when did you first read Orlando?
I read it in England. I was studying in England for a year when I was, I guess, 20, and I read it then and absolutely loved it.
Do you have a favorite line in your adaptation?
Well, I love the line that David Greenspan has, "Life, life, life," cried the bird. And Orlando's always trying to write this epic poem, and she's writing, and she says, "What's life?" She asked a bird, "Life, life, life," cried the bird. And Virginia Woolf was really obsessed with birds, and I just learned this recently, which is kind of heartbreaking, but when she went sort of mad, she thought she could hear the birds speaking in Greek. But the bird is this powerful image in all of her work, but in this you have a wild goose that seems very important at the end, and you have a kingfisher, and you have other birds, but it seems like birds become this, I hate to choose the word symbol because it's so overwrought, but they carry a lot of meaning in terms of a bid for freedom and the relationship between our ordinary world and the heavens somehow.
I think my favorite line is David Greenspan again in the second half of the play when forgive me if I paraphrase, but it's something like the dead have wonderful memories. Mm-hmm. Every time I hear that, a flood of thoughts come over my head.
I think I might have written that line. I try to say so faithful to Woolf. I mean, usually it's always Woolf, and it was very hard revisiting the novel this time around because I love the novel so much. I just thought, oh God, I'd like to put this line and this line and this line. I'd like to put the whole novel in. I just think her mind was so incandescent. It's very hard to leave anything out.
Well, this leads me to my next question is, you know, there are some playwrights who like to be very present during rehearsals, and there are some playwrights who like to come to the first read through and then chat and then maybe come for opening. And then obviously there are lots of in between. Where are you on the spectrum, like how in relation to Orlando?
I like to come. I really like to be here. I mean, I love this cast, so it's also just pure pleasure watching them.
It's a great company.
Who wouldn't want to be in a room watching them work? And I love working with Rebecca and Annie B. It's my first time working with Annie B., our choreographer. And also, I don't generally work with choreographers, so that's also been pure pleasure for me to watch her make dances and to watch the actors absorb them. So really, it's also relaxing for me to be in rehearsal because I have 3 kids under the age of 5, so being here is like a little spa. I just can sit and watch.
And I saw one of your kids at Tech on the first day, right?
I tend to bring one at all, you know, often.
Well, she was very well behaved. I don't think she made a sound whatsoever. I'm just curious what, if any, the revision process has been like for Orlando. Has it changed much since you originally wrote it, or?
I have done a fair amount. I mean, I was commissioned to write this, I think it was 12 years ago, quite a long time ago, by the Piven Theater Workshop, which was like my home theater in Chicago. And I think the good thing about my youth when I wrote the first draft was I didn't know enough to be scared. So Joyce Piven said, could you adapt Orlando? I said, no, sure, you know, sure, no problem. And I think I'd be so daunted now if someone asked me, I'm like, oh God, how do you do that? So I think that that's good that I did it a long time ago, but coming back, interestingly, Orlando, the character at the end of the novel, is 36. She says, who then am I? I'm 36, owns a motor car. A woman, yes, but a million other things as well. And I'm 36 now. So coming back when I'm 36 feels like a different thing in terms of what I'm looking at in the novel. So I don't think I changed huge structural elements, but definitely made cuts and incorporated new bits.
My last question is, our space here at Classic Stage Company is very unique in the sense of the relationship between the stage and the audience. It's very intimate. I'm just curious, perhaps, what's the most challenging thing of presenting Orlando at this type of theater, and perhaps what is the most rewarding thing that you've found so far?
I desperately crave an intimate relationship with the audience, so to me that's great. I mean, I think also Orlando is, the way I adapted it, it includes a lot of narration. And you know, I grew up in Chicago where you, when you do narration, that's not a big thing. It's just totally normal to speak to the audience with no fourth wall with narration. And I think you want a really direct pipeline to the audience with that kind of work. So I'm thrilled about the intimacy of the space. And you have like the best coffee in New York, right? Right in the cafe. So the space itself and the beautiful back wall and all of that is wonderful.
Well, it has been a joy talking to you this afternoon. Thank you so much for coming. And to all the listeners out there, we hope you will come see Sarah Ruhl's adaptation of Virginia Woolf's Orlando, which runs now through October 17th. Thank you very much. Signing off.
Thank you.